Luke 2:8-14. Luke 2:8-14. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were greatly afraid, and then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord, and this will be a sign to you. And you will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." You've heard me say before that this is my favorite time of the year. Wonderful season, Thanksgiving into Christmas season, which at this time, it always reminds me of the promise that the angel and the multitude said on that first Christmas over 2,000 years ago. Those words reverberate probably now more than ever, where they said, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men." How we need to hear those words and how we need the fulfillment of that promise at this present time. There's a fallacy out there that says that during the Thanksgiving and the Christmas season, that the suicide rate rises. Well, that's a fallacy, but one thing is true. The rates of depression do rise at this time of the year. And in fact, a study says that this year, with this fierce COVID battle that's going on, that the rate of depression are triple that of pre-COVID. And there's so much stress, and it seems to be that there's so little peace in this season that is known for a time of peace and goodwill toward men. And so I want to encourage you on how you can still have a peaceful time and have peace in your heart, even in these times. Let me share with you just some thoughts on how to have and maintain peace in this season of peace. Even if you feel a lot of stress around you, I want to show you how you can be at peace. Number one, I encourage you to believe God loves you enough to take care of you. I know of a pastor whose name is Greg, and this young pastor, he heard God speak to his heart one day, and God said to him, "Greg, try with all your heart to bankrupt me." And that man began a journey of living by faith, and that man lived by faith, and in that faith walk, he always prayed in his needs to be met. And he said, "I loved praying in needs and seeing God come through in the 11th hour, the 59th minute, and the 55th second." And so he grew his kids up that way as well. They would always pray for their food, and he remembers one particular time when they would sit down, and they were to sit down at their normal time of eating, and they didn't have a single thing in the house except salt and pepper. And on one particular day, his six-year-old son, 20 years ago, came to him at 5 o'clock, which was always the time when the son was to set the table. And he comes to his father because he knows there's no food in the house, and he says, "Daddy, what should I do?" And he said, "Ben, what time is it?" And Ben said, "It's 5 o'clock. And he said, "Well, what do you do at 5 o'clock? And Ben, the son, said, "I lay out the table." And his father said this, "Well, then off you go and do it." Then they sat down, and he said to them, "Let's hold hands just like we always do and pray, and let's give thanks." Now, there was a four-year-old child sitting at that table as well. And he looked at his father before they began to pray, and he said, "Daddy, there isn't any food." And he looked at his son and he said, "Seth, by the time I say amen, food will be on this table." He's halfway through the prayer of thanks and the doorbell rings. It's their neighbor. She says, "Have you eaten yet?" He said, "We were thinking about it." And she said, "I just cooked a meal for my family and my brother, who I haven't seen in 17 years. He just turned up and he wants to take us all out to dinner." Then she said, "I don't want this food to spoil. Would you like it?" She brings in bowls and bowls of steaming hot food. They put it down. They say thanks to her. They close the door. They sit down, and Daddy says, "Now, where was I? Oh, yes, I was praying." And he said, "Father, thank you for this food. Amen." Now, little four-year-old Seth is sitting there. His eyes are wide open, and he stops in the middle of eating his food, and he says, "Daddy, what's for breakfast?" Watch now. Daddy said, "Son, what would you like for breakfast?" And the little fellow names his favorite breakfast cereal, and Daddy said, "When you get up in the morning, on our doorstep, will be a box of your favorite breakfast cereal because God loves you. He wakes up at 4 o'clock in the morning, goes downstairs and opens the door. And sure enough, a box of groceries is on the step, including a box of his favorite cereal. And Daddy has got to get up at 4 a.m. to make him breakfast. You see, that is ultimate faith, church. Because faith ultimately is believing that God loves you enough to take care of you. And that ought to give you peace in this season of peace. Secondly, avoid floundering in the pool of unforgiveness. Unforgiveness is a peace stealer. There are some of you who are listening to me, you say that you have forgiven people that you actually have not forgiven. And until you do, don't you know that God is going to keep holding your blessing in reserve? Because I really want you to grab this, especially in this season of Thanksgiving and Christmas celebration. Unforgiveness keeps blessings imprisoned and locked up. Let me go a little bit further because some of you are not at this place right now. But watch out. The moment that God begins to bless us at any time, the devil always seems to send somebody our way to offend us and cause us to pick up a spirit of offense. Which God says, if you have aught against your brother or you know they have aught against you and you're bringing your gift to an altar and you're coming to be blessed by God, he says, stop right there, take care of those things and fix them. Because if you don't, you won't be blessed. If you want peace in this season of peace, avoid floundering in the pool of unforgiveness. Let me give you one more thought today about peace. Avoid the pitfall of impatience. We are a nation of impatient people. There is a saying that says the proof is in the pudding, and the pandemic is the pudding. So many people are so impatient, and we can't sacrifice doing certain things simply for 1 year so that we might get beyond this place and we don't want to interrupt our family traditions. And so many people are just struggling letting go of some things for a season until we get over this, not understanding that sacrifice for a season is worth it for a lifetime. I saw a tag that says, a Zoom Thanksgiving is better than an ICU Christmas. Listen now, so many are discouraged and lack peace because they lack patience. There is a saying that is more than a cliche, the best things really do come to those who wait. When Jesus was born of the Holy Spirit, and to be born of the Holy Spirit, the angel of the Lord told Mary, said, Mary, you're highly favored of the Lord. And he said, Mary, you're going to give birth to God in the flesh, the Savior of the world. But when I think about this story, there's an angle that we don't ever consider. Mary had to wait 33 years for the manifestation of that promise. For 33 years, all Mary could actually see was that she had given birth to another son. For 33 years, she watched Jesus grow off, giving off no evidence that he really was God in the flesh and the Savior of the world. And I said that to say this, that I do not doubt that at some point she lost sight of the reality of that first Christmas. In fact, the Bible says that his own brothers and sisters didn't realize that he was the Messiah. But yet every once in a while, something would happen, a miracle here, a miracle there. And Mary would remember the promise of that day that did not come into fruition until the third day, 33 years later. See, blessing may not come today. It may not come tomorrow. It may not come when we think it ought to come. And it may seem that God is late. But let me say it one more time. God is the only one I know that when he is late, he is right on time. And so in this season of peace, you will find peace if you avoid the pitfall of impatience, avoid floundering at the pool of unforgiveness, and then most of all, believe God loves you enough to take care of you. As the sign on our church wall always says, and I always quote, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. Amen.